Well, good morning. I'm Trevor Danzer. I'm lead pastor here at First United Methodist Church, and I want to extend Pastor Karen's welcome and thank you for tuning in today or on TV or YouTube later, wherever we get these crazy technology things these days. We're going to begin a series today called Understanding Evil, everybody's favorite topic, right? It's a series that's meant to dive into the complexities and the nuances of evil from a biblical perspective, and then ultimately, how do we deal with it? What do we do about it, or what can we even do about it? And it's all too convenient to just simply lump the evils onto the devil. There's plenty of scriptural support for the idea of a devil, but evil is simply put, evil is more creative, more subtle, and more potent than any simple deity whose purpose it is to thwart whatever God is doing. Evil is much more complex than that. Furthermore, evil has this unique way of always staying up to date. It never lags behind in technology or sociology or psychology. Evil always has a tendency to use whatever avenues it can around it. In other words, it finds a way to be eerily always relevant, which is why every culture, nation, every generation has wrestled with understanding evil. Lance Morrow was a Time author, or writer, for several years, and he wrote a book. It's simply called Evil. And at the introduction of the book, he has this question that I think is interesting. It's thought-provoking, and it's not really earth-shattering, but here it is. It says, who is really an expert on evil? Who should we interview? Is it a police officer? A priest? A torturer? A victim? A serial killer? Evil is never mastered and never really fully understood, only considered and processed. I love that, the fact that every single one of us has experienced evil in our life one way or the other, many to varying different degrees for sure. But we've all touched evil in our own life, and none of us are ever really experts. Because evil is sometimes elusive. It's hard to get our talons around. It's hard to really grasp and understand and fully anticipate. And every culture, nearly every culture, has an origin story of evil. And I will warn you that many of the most famous ones are admittedly, looking at this side of history, admittedly rather sexist. Perhaps one of the most famous origin stories comes from the country of Greece, kind of the forefathers of Western civilization. This is a Greek mythology about gods and how they interact with the human beings. And I remind you that Prometheus is one of those that made a misstep and gave human beings fire, the gift that was only meant for the gods, according to Greek mythology. So Prometheus gave fire to the gods, and as punishment, gods gave human beings a woman in the name of Pandora. And some of the text, depending on your translation and how you interpret it, it was either a jar or a box. It doesn't necessarily matter. But this jar, this box, contained all the evils in the world, disease, plagues, natural disasters, earthquakes, the whole gambit of things would come out into the world. And all she had to do was just simply keep the jar or box closed. Long story short, she ended up opening it and then unleashing evils into the world. Before she realized what was happening, she began to close the box or jar rather quickly, and trapping hope is the last thing to be contained. It's a story that's meant to try and explain the origins of evil and how evil existed in the world and how it is entirely encompassing of the human experience. But every story and every culture, as you read through the origins of evil, attempt to do three things. One is to name that evil, in fact, does exist. The second is that we must, in fact, deal with it. And third is that we are part of the problem. As human beings, we contribute to evil in varying ways. Our scripture today is from Adam and Eve, the story in Genesis 3, this early story of God's first creations of Adam and Eve. And their job is to take care of God's garden. That's their sole job. That's their sole existence, is to care for the garden. Except there's one tree that they're not supposed to eat from, this tree of knowledge of good and evil. And the serpent comes up to him, and the serpent actually, if you read through it, doesn't actually do anything at all. He just tempts them. He invites them to think about something in a different way than God intended for them to think about it. He says, why don't you just eat of that, and you'll know the difference between good and evil. And so they do. They eat, they realize their nakedness, their shame enters the world for the first time, and then they become all too aware that they fall short, that they're vulnerable, or more importantly, that they're not immortal, that they're finite. So whether you take that story to be literal or symbolic, whether you think there was an actual Adam and Eve, or whether you think its story is a myth in the best sense of the word, that it's meant to convey a truth about the origins of evil, all of them, whatever way you come to it, admits that evil exists, that we have to deal with it, and that we are part of the problem. So then evil, if we were to give a definition to it from a biblical perspective, simply is this, is when one person puts themselves over another, including God. It means when one person thinks higher of themselves than what they really are, whenever we think we know something better over someone else, whenever we think we are ourselves more valuable or more worthy than someone else, evil is the result. It ensues from there on. Behind me is this heart that Paul Limley made for us this week. And it's a heart that's, whether you know it or not, is meant to describe or embody a sense of evil, being in each of our capacities to perform evil. And it comes from this quote by a Russian author, philosopher, named Alexander Solzhenitsyn. And here's the kind of a long quote of what he says. It says, the line separating good and evil passes not through states, nor between classes, nor between political parties either, but right through every human heart, and through all human hearts. The line shifts. Inside us, it oscillates with the years, and even within hearts overwhelmed by evil, one small bridgehead of God is retained. If only it were so simple, and this is the most famous quoted part of this passage, if only it were all so simple, if only there were evil people somewhere insidiously committing evil deeds, and it were necessary only to separate them from the rest of us and destroy them. But the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. And who is willing to destroy a piece of his own heart? That line, that thin line between good and evil cuts through every human heart, meaning every single one of us has the capacity to commit evil, to think evil, to contribute to evil, to destroy good in the world, and thwart the very thing that God is trying to do in us and through us. And friends, it's far too easy to try and separate us from evil or yourself from evil. And we use words to try and simplify categories by using words such as us and them and those people. But if we really stop to think, if we're really honest with ourselves, all of us have the capacity to do evil. Think about it this way. On this side of history, there are things that have happened that we can say, this is atrocious, and how could anybody let it happen? You know, think of the millions of people that rooted for and were rallying behind Adolf Hitler as he took the reins of Chancellor of Germany in the years leading up to World War II and decimated 11 million people off the face of the planet with cruelty and hate that we still teach our children about today. Think about this, 2 to 10 million people that we didn't even deem worthy to count, were killed by King Leopold of Belgium during the early Industrial Revolution, when we discovered rubber plants in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and we wanted that value, that treasure, so much so that we were willing to exploit and colonize 2 to 10 million people so that we could fill our cars and our bikes with rubber. Or even in our own country, the years between 1942 and 1945, we had a policy as a recourse of Pearl Harbor, rounding up Americans with Japanese descent and throwing them into internment camps with horrible conditions, killing 1,800 plus Americans on American soil. And at the time, many didn't even bat an eye. Evil is always easier to identify in hindsight than in the present age. Today, there are more slaves in the world than there ever have been before, largely through sex trafficking and payday loans, Where we create systems where people are literally unable to get out of it and be indentured to others legally for the rest of their lives. And many of us simply watch it and let it go by. Every single one of us has the capacity to bear witness to, and if not participate, at least let it go of evil. So the question is, how do we struggle against it? What do we do? And while that answer is far too complex to be answered just in the next 5 minutes, well, at least I want to start. So I want to give you 3 steps to sort of help us think about how we might begin to be anti-evil. You know, in the midst of conversations of racism in our own day and age today, I'm learning that it's not enough to be just non-racist. It's not enough to just not carry those values, that we actually have to fight against it to be anti-racist. In the same way, and if we want to really fight against evil, it's not enough to simply be non-evil. It's not enough to live in our own little bubble and live our own little good life and treasure all the things that be good. We actually have to be part of a movement to end evil in whatever forms it represents itself. So here's the first thing we need to do. And this may sound childish, this may sound cliche-ish and naive, and perhaps it is, but I choose to hold on to it as the first step, because without it, nothing else makes sense. And it's simply this: know that evil cannot win. Simply put, it just can't win. Every culture that has an origin story of evil, spoiler alert, at the end of time, evil loses. It may not make any sense. We may not be able to see it at any point, but it does. In the Bible, the very last book of the Bible is called Revelation. And it's a story that many historically might say it's a book about overthrowing the Roman Empire. But theologically, we can say it is a book about overthrowing evil in its last stage. And the beast there is this embodiment of all things that are evil. Some might associate it with the devil. Some might associate it with just evil, human corruption, whatever it might be. And this beast, it gets up thrown into a lake of fire. And it ceases to exist, to no longer ever have any power in the world. And so nearing the end of the Bible, evil is ultimately defeated. Even if it doesn't make sense, even if we don't see it here and now, evil will lose. No, this isn't, I'm not going to compare this to evil, but we know that the Super Bowl this last year was tense, shall we say, and that we, as the Chiefs, were almost out of it and finally pulled through at the very end. Imagine if you were to go back and watch that replay that some of you undoubtedly have watched many times, and it may be the only Super Bowl we get coming up, quite frankly, but we know that if we watch it again and we know how it ends, the anxiety will be less. You won't have the heart palpitations that happen in halftime and third quarter. You just know how it ends. And so it is true. We, as Christian followers of believers of Jesus, that we have to have the conviction that evil cannot win. We know how the story ends. Even if we don't know the details of it, we know the end result. And that allows us then to have the power and the conviction to do what's required of us and do what's next. The second is this: to know that we can't sit on our hands and sit back and watch it. That we have to actively practice doing good. We have to actively practice doing good. Miroslav Volf has this book called End of Memory, and he has this quote that I'll share with you. He says, "To triumph fully, evil needs 2 victories, not one. The first victory happens when the evil deed is perpetrated, and the second victory when the evil is returned. After the first victory, evil would die if the second victory did not infuse it with new life." If we aren't being anti-evil, if we aren't actively practicing doing good and promoting good as a replacement of evil, then evil is guaranteed a first victory and likely a second. And the cycle just continues and continues if good people sit on our hands and do nothing. We have to actively practice doing good. It can be small things, it could be big things, whatever it might be. I don't drink coffee, so I never visit Scooters, but I've heard that there's this pattern here, and some of you can tell me if this is right or not, but there's this pattern of customers that go through Scooters here in Jefferson City that it's not uncommon to pay for the ice cream, that's where I go, the coffee of somebody behind you. And there's this chain that just kind of does it, and it's sort of like almost expected, and people just do it, and I love it. It's a tangible sign of actively doing something good in our own small way. I believe it was Desmond Tutu that said, I'm going to butcher the quote here. He said, but do all the little acts of kindness in your own sphere, and those together overwhelm the world. We do little acts of goodness every day, intentionally, purposefully, not to make ourselves feel better, not even to make somebody else happy, but to say, to give evil a little lurk, a little warning that it won't win. Several years ago, I was serving a church, and there was a wealthy businessman that came up to me during Christmas time and handed me $2,000 in cash. And he said, I want you to take this, and I want you to just give it to people in our community that you think need it. That was a really cool gift for me to just be able to go and bless people in various ways. And so one of the things I did is I went to, we were working with a drug treatment court. And these were men and women that have succumbed to drug addiction and are seeking to overcome it. And some of them have lost custody of their children because of it and lost their jobs. And they've been in this intentional program surrounded by people that love them and encourage them and believe in them and help them overcome the evils of addiction and get their life back together. And this very intense system is in place and surrounding by good people and going through all these coaching classes. And anyway, and so I knew there was one woman in this class that had just recently regained custody of her daughter, and she desperately needed a crib for her baby. And so we worked it out with a couple of other people that were with the court system, and we timed it so that she was home. And so I went on her door, and I knocked on her door, and I just said, hey, we heard that you need a crib for your baby, and so here's $300 to go buy it. You just take it, you do it what you want. And there was this little pause, this little moment where she was a little uncertain if what was actually happening was real life or if she was dreaming. And it was just this moment where she began to really fundamentally, tactilely see that people love her and believe in her and want nothing but the best for her. It was an amazing moment. I learned later that just seconds after I left her door, the first people she called were the people that worked with her in the drug court. They became friends. They became family. That was good being proactively placed in the world and overthrowing evil. Whatever ways you can, actively practice good as a way to be anti-evil. And the third is the most important and probably the most difficult step I can offer you today. Third is this: search your own heart. That thin line between good and evil that runs through our heart is real. It oscillates, it changes over time, but it never leaves us. We all have the capacity to act in self-absorption, to let greed and pride and self-interest dominate our life at the expense of others around us. We can choose to live our life as though we are in a community dependent upon other people, or we can try and build our own fortress until we have enough, and then we can practice generosity. But that line overshadows us from time to time. It is always tracking us, stalking us, always inviting us, like the serpent in the garden, to do something that God wouldn't ask us to do, inviting us to live life for ourselves rather than for one another. You know, this is explained to me using mathematical logic, but whenever you're born and you're growing up, you have certain traditions and experiences in your life. And by default, you can't help but do this. We all naturally do this, whether we know it or not. But you can think of it that we assign a value to that of one, of this is my custom, our tradition, what's expected of us. It's one. And whenever we get exposed to people that are different than us from a different culture, a different experience, or think of life differently, or live life differently than we do, we, by default, instinctively add a sign of value of that less than one, maybe a 0.5 or 0.4, or maybe even as low as 0.1 or 0. We immediately define our normal as norm, and anything outside of it as abnormal or different or less than. It's natural for us to do this, and this is one of the ways that thin line of evil works within our hearts. Begins to coax us and tell us that people are different and abnormal, and you are the one that is right and perfect and good, and therefore you're worthy of more than others. If that thin line wasn't there, why would we need Jesus? if our lives are good and perfect and we got it all figured out, then we wouldn't need Jesus. We wouldn't need God to come and die on the cross and rise from the grave for us. But the truth is we do. And that all of us have bias and prejudices that are bent toward our favor. And evil thrives on it. So we must search our own heart. Be willing to name the ways in which we are perhaps unjust to those around us. And then recognize that our own life is a vehicle by which evil enters the world and interacts and changes. You know, whenever you join the church, we go through a liturgy of baptism. And part of that baptism liturgy is asking ourselves individually and collectively if we will resist the forces of evil and oppression in whatever forms that present themselves. And we stand up and we say we do, and the church responds and says we do too, and then often we just don't think about it from there on. But if we call ourselves Christians and followers of Jesus, then we have to take that commitment seriously. Do we actually believe that we are fighting against evil and make that commitment to happen? So every week through the series, we're going to have some rendition of this liturgy. So I'm going to invite you, the liturgy will be on the screen, I'm going to invite you to respond appropriately in your section. It's a way for us to bring in that baptismal liturgy into our call today. So let us begin. Through our baptism, we are called to renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness and reject the evil powers of the world.
As Jesus' followers, we accept the freedom and power God gives us to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves.
May God show us the way. The existence of evil is real and present. Will you affirm our call to resist evil and seek to act as God's agents to bring about justice and goodwill, communicating the goodness of Christ Jesus, who has the power to defeat death and bring about evil's ultimate end?
We affirm our call. We confess that we have seen and experienced evil. We confess our capacity for evil and ask for forgiveness. Today, we recommit ourselves once more as followers of Christ to fight against evil in the many forms it presents itself, even in ourselves.
May we continuously become new in Christ, to be transformed, to defeat evil, and to promote good.
May the Holy Spirit be with us. May it open our eyes, ears, mind, and heart to all the places that evil might lurk. May we be ambassadors of good and enemies of evil.